I'm Mark Halperin.
And I'm John Heilemann. And with all due respect to John Boehner, so, a fleshy Lucifer, huh?
Ted Cruz is Lucifer in the flesh.
John Boehner, in a public appearance, calling Ted Cruz, quote,
Lucifer in the flesh.
Lucifer in the flesh.
Lucifer in the flesh.
Night of the Living Ted, demonology fans, on the show tonight. God, that music is really spooky. Carly's deal with the devil, Indiana's Judgment Day, and the Stop Trump folks try one last exorcism. But first, the cult of Donald Trump's machismo. Over the past 24 hours, the Republican frontrunner has been doubling down on his testosterone don image. And yes, I know I'm misspelling it. We know we're mispronouncing it. You must have some respect for poetry, people. In an interview with the Today Show this morning, Trump repeated his claim that Hillary Clinton would not be a viable presidential candidate or even a city council candidate if she weren't playing the, quote, woman card, end quote. And this afternoon, Trump and his campaign pushed that tough guy tone even further at a rally at Elkhart, Indiana, with the legendary basketball coach and ranter, Bobby Knight.
You know, Bobby called me up. He called me up about a year ago, and he said to me, hey, Donald, I don't know him. I didn't know him. I knew of him. He was, to me, the best. You don't get any better. Tough, tough. Would you say he was tough enough? Would you say? But, you know, not just tough. Smart, tactical. He was a winner. He was a winner and still is a winner. Believe me, the best.
Let me first tell you that I was very, very selective with players during the time I was here. And I'll tell you one thing, that man that was just up here a moment ago, I'll tell you, that son of a bitch could play for me.
That son of a bitch. All right. Trump's campaign also has a new TV ad up in Indiana featuring Donald Trump Jr. talking again about how tough, tough, tough his dad is. So, Mark, this testosterone don thing, smart, dumb, somewhere in between.
Somewhere in between. I think it needs to be calibrated. That ad running in Indiana with Donald Trump Jr. also includes a little flash of Donald Trump Sr. playing with his grandkids. So they're recognized that they need to soften him a little bit. This is the quintessence of letting Trump be Trump. This is the kind of personality he has. It plays to his strength. Clearly, at some point, some women might find this appealing. Clearly, at some point, I think they need to use Ivanka and Mrs. Trump and others to round it out. But this is him. He doesn't back down. He believes what he said about Hillary Clinton. May not work, but I think when they try to make him back down or when they try to sand off the rough edges, it's not going to work. He's going to win or lose as machismo.
Well, that's great. Fabulous. You know, I said yesterday on our show that Donald Trump has a huge problem with women voters. If he doesn't solve that problem, he can't be president of the United States. So he can be him if he wants to be, if he wants to continue down this path and continue. I don't think the things he did in these instances is offensive, but he is going to have to do something to remediate this problem in some substantial degree. You know, maybe he'll do it later, maybe he'll do it now. But I remember a guy named Mitt Romney in 2012 who just refused to defend Bain, who refused to do, in the face of all the assaults from the Obama campaign. He stuck to his principles, too, and he got eviscerated. So I think Trump needs to fix this problem.
There are tens of millions of Americans who love Hillary Clinton. They love her personality. They love what she stands for. They love the prospect of her being president. But there are tens of millions of American women who don't feel that way.
I agree.
And is Trump's route to them this way, or is it some more nuanced thing? I think it's a combination, but I'll say again, in any other campaign, they would not have followed yesterday or Tuesday night's remark with this kind of display.
Right.
But this is what Trump is about. This is what he's like.
And you don't need to be clear. When I say he needs to fix this problem, I don't mean he has to like swing 180 degrees in some other direction and do all kinds of pandering things to women. That's not the point. And again, to also be clear, I don't think anything he did this day was offensive. I just think there's still a lot of like there is this sense of like we're going to be tough. We're not going to back down. I'm not going to ever admit a mistake. I'm never going to even sand off a little bit of a rough edge. I'm just not sure that's smart.
And back to Reagan, the press obsesses about the gender gap only in one direction. Trump's going to do very well with men, and Hillary Clinton has to worry about that to some extent if they face each other in the general. All right, now it is our turn to say it. Lucifer in the flesh. That's the political phrase of the day.
I should have said it with you.
And what former Speaker of the House John Boehner, a Republican, called Ted Cruz last night in an event in California at Stanford University. That reminds us all just how much some denizens of Capitol Hill dislike intensely the gentleman from Texas. According to the respected Stanford Daily, while Boehner called himself and Donald Trump, quote, texting buddies who have golfed together in the past, former speaker did not hold back his feelings about Cruz. He said also, quote, I have Democrat friends and Republican friends. I get along with almost everyone, but I have never worked with a more miserable son of a bitch in my life, speaking about Ted Cruz. Here's how Cruz responded to all this at an event this morning in Fort Wayne, Indiana.
When John Boehner calls me Lucifer, he's not directing that at me. He's directing that at you. What Boehner is angry with me for is not anything I've ever said to him. I haven't said much of anything to him. What Boehner is angry with me for is standing with the American people, is energizing and encouraging House conservatives to stand with the American people and actually honor the commitments we've made.
All right, so this spat comes at a pretty pivotal moment for the Republican Party. The central question in the nomination race right now is whether the balance of power in the GOP is becoming increasingly resigned to coalescing around Trump as their candidate for the fall, or if the Stop Trump faction can hold its ground and maybe grow before Trump can sew up the nomination. There's small sign today of which way this pivotal tug-of-war is going. Trump got another congressional endorsement. He hasn't gotten many, this one from Pennsylvania Congressman Bill Schuster. Meanwhile, the already fragile alliance between Ted Cruz and John Kasich, key to any success that the Stop Trump movement might have, seems to be fraying even more. When asked about the alliance in Fort Wayne today, Cruz denied there ever was collusion between the two campaigns, immediately after which Kasich's top strategist, John Weaver, tweeted, quote, I can't stand liars. All right, so, John, the Indiana
primary. With that tone, you would say that.
I read tone into the tweet. Indiana primaries Tuesday.
Yeah.
As you look within Indiana and nationally, is the Stop Trump movement growing or shrinking?
Well, I don't know that it's shrinking, but it seems to me that there are a lot of people who were in neither the Stop Trump movement nor in the pro-Trump movement, people who have been holding their fire slowly, gradually, and maybe there'll be a lot more after Indiana if Donald Trump wins. But right now, there's a small trickle going into the pro-Trump or the Trump acquiescence, Trump capitulation side. And that's bad news for the Stop Trump movement because the Stop Trump movement is static and it's not being particularly effective, yeah, which is the key thing.
It has to grow to stop him because at its current size, it's not done much to slow him down, Wisconsin being the big exception. You saw today the governor of Florida once again saying, we got to get behind Trump, another congressional endorsement. But everything I'm hearing is there are a lot of people who are poised to give up and throw in the towel after Tuesday if Trump wins Indiana.
Could be true. But I will say one of the things that all of this has pointed out, the Boehner comments about Cruz, the back and forth between Weaver, this Stop Trump movement is going to be hard to stop him. This group is so ragtag and so ineffective and ham-handed, the group that is now represented the face of the Stop Trump movement, Ted Cruz and John Kasich. Kasich has performed miserably, and Cruz is incredibly disliked. And the Boehner thing points that out. It's never been far from the surface, but he's the worst possible person to be the standard bearer for trying to stop a locomotive-like freight train of a front runner.
Yep, and Hillary Clinton, John Boehner like Hillary Clinton, and Boehner also says some nice things about Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
They like interesting personalities. Donald Trump is a likable, interesting personality to a lot of people.
And
Ted Cruz
is
not so much.
Not so much to a lot of people. Right.
But not to everybody.
Not to everybody. His wife likes him a lot. All right. When we come back, our review of Carla Fiorina's first full day as Ted Cruz's running mate, how she's doing, and more after this quick break.
As most of you will certainly note in your journals, today was Carla Fiorina's first full day as a hypothetical vice presidential candidate. She did a round robin of television interviews this morning, plus three events in the Hoosier State with Ted Cruz attacking Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and talking up her new BFF / running mate, Ted Cruz. Here's a representative sampling of some of the things she said.
Hillary Clinton's made her millions selling access and influence, and Donald Trump has made his billions buying people like Hillary Clinton off. They will not fight the system, although they claim to do so to win a job that they aspire to. They are the system.
It works for people like Donald Trump. He's big and powerful and wealthy and well-connected.
but it doesn't work for most of us. And so what you have here is a fearless fighter who, as a conservative, understands that the thing that ails us is too much money and too much power concentrated in the hands of too few.
All right, the Cruz campaign is also featuring Fiorina in a new television ad. It's going up on the air in Indiana, complete with this distinct, amusing ending.
I'm Ted Cruz.
I'm Carly Fiorina.
And we approve this message.
Adorable. All right. So, John, how is Carly Fiorina doing so far as Ted Cruz's hypothetical running mate?
She has, as far as I can see, having watched these interviews and seen how she's performed, she's doing about as well as she did as a presidential candidate, which is to say, she's not really leaving much of a mark. She's not doing anything, to my mind. I thought yesterday she's mostly going to be a wash. I don't think she's going to hurt him in Indiana. I don't think she's going to help him very much. There's nothing that she's done this morning in terms of these interviews that I've seen that changes my calculation about how much I think she's going to help or hurt, which is like basically zip.
All running mate combos are symbolic and stagecraft. There's no substance here, right? So I'd still think that the fact that they campaigned together so much, the fact that they telegraphed this pick for days, it's really taken the wow factor out of it.
Yeah.
If they had not campaigned together, if they hadn't telegraphed it, I think this thing would have more of an impact. Carly Fiorina doing cable interviews and introducing Ted Cruz events, been
big
there,
deal.
Seen there,
big
done,
deal.
Seen this, done that.
For weeks before.
So I think it's helping. I think it's energizing the Cruz campaign. It's giving them something to talk about, but it's not transforming the race, which you could have imagined picks that have transformed the race.
Well, and look, that's one of my issues here is that, like, if you're going to throw a Hail Mary pass. This isn't a Hail Mary.
Right.
This is like a medium length pass down the field. Like, put somebody on the ticket who really would have shocked the world, some woman of some prominence who we all would have been really genuinely surprised by, who would have been a real game changer, to coin a phrase.
Like Julia Childs.
Or Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
You know,
I don't know.
I'll take your sports metaphor. They threw a Hail Mary. They completed it, but they're still down 30 points.
Yes, well, and they're still 20 yards short of the goal line.
Yeah.
It's just not going to, and I think she's going to have to ask her a lot of questions about outsourcing eventually, and that's not going to be pretty in Indiana. Okay, so Bernie Sanders and his team, they're sending out some mixed signals about the future of his campaign, again, not for the first time, and what it hopes to accomplish following that bruising defeat in 4 out of 5 states on Tuesday. Yesterday, as we mentioned on the show, the New York Times reported that the campaign, Sanders' campaign, that is laying off a couple hundred staff members across the country and refocusing its resources on California, which votes on June 7. And yet, Bernie's wife, Jane, was out on the cable shows today saying unequivocally that her husband is, quote, absolutely in it to win, end quote. Fundraising, never been a problem for Bernie Sanders, quite the contrary. He reportedly has more than $17 million sitting in his bank account. So, Mark, my question for you, given all that dough, why is Sanders laying off staff? What's necessary? What does that mean? And what impact does it have on the race?
On the one hand, you could say, of course, they're laying off staff because there are fewer contests coming up and they had a very big staff. They don't need as many people now with fewer races to go. On the other hand, this campaign has mishandled big symbolic moments. If you want to convince people that you're in it, you're still trying, you've still got a chance, you cannot lay off this many people. Figure out a way. Or if you're going to, be ready to explain it better than the way they did. So, they spent a lot of money. There's a new Washington Post story talking about how they spent a lot of money on consultants, which may not sit so well with their small dollar donors. But this is just, it doesn't mean all that much in the scheme of things, except it shows once again that for as good as they've been on so many things, they haven't handled this kind of thing very well.
And let's be clear, they have been very good on some very big things. This campaign, in many ways, even more than the Trump campaign, is a miracle what they've accomplished. The people around Bernie Sanders are incredibly, incredibly good. They've done an amazing job.
But amen.
It is the truth that the campaign had 1,000 people working for it, I'm told by informed sources in Iowa. They've gradually been ratcheting that number down, as most campaigns do, as the number of states recede. And they've been leapfrogging people from state to state, and now they're just kind of running out of runway. In some sense, it's the most natural thing in the world. But to your point, if it's the most natural thing in the world, the day when it happens to be the day after you've lost 4 out of 5 and you happen to be cutting your staff by nearly half just because of the proportions, you got to figure out some way to tell that story that doesn't make it look like you're giving up.
And I'll say one thing. California, really big. I bet you those people could have gone to California, at least some of them, and done something maybe more useful than giving money to the consultants.
Like I say, if you explain it better, do something to have this not be read in the way it's been read.
They've also spent a lot more money in the last couple weeks than some people realize, perhaps. All right, up next, more on the GOP race and Donald Trump's path to the nomination after this quick break. Welcome back. Joining us now, MSNBC reporter on the Stop Trump beat, Casey Hunt, who joins us from Indianapolis, and Katie Turr, NBC News reporter covering Donald Trump here in the studio. Ladies, thank you for joining us. Casey, there's been very little polling in Indiana on the Republican side. You've been out there for a while. What's your sense from talking to folks about where Trump stands vis-a-vis Cruz in advance of Tuesday?
Hi, guys. Yeah, the people that I've been talking to on the ground here over the course of the last couple of days basically say that there was some data they were looking at early in the week, of course, you know, kind of internal polling stuff the party was doing, that showed Trump actually on the rise. And, of course, that was before those big victories early in the week and before, of course, Cruz stepped in it a little bit, called it a basketball ring. So people I've talked to are a little skeptical that he's going to be able to pull this out against Donald Trump. And there's a sense on the ground that there are a combination of things that are sort of limiting Cruz at this point. You guys were talking a little bit earlier in the show about Carly Fiorina. I definitely think you're right about the lack of wow factor here. That was something else I've been hearing.
Katie, my interactions with the Trump folks since Tuesday have been led me to believe that they feel pretty confident about Indiana. What's your sense?
Same thing. I've spoken to senior aides, and they believe that they have an advantage in Indiana because they went on the air a week before Ted Cruz did.
And there's been early voting going on.
Exactly, and they haven't quite spent as much money, so they tout that as well. But I don't think they feel like they need Indiana as much as they might have needed it if they had not come out of the five states on Tuesday with such a strong delegate, when especially when it comes to those unbound delegates in Pennsylvania. So I think they're feeling confident. I think Indiana would be the cherry on top of their sundae, but it's not something that they're necessarily banking
on. It's almost as if they're liberated, John, that they don't need to win it, and therefore they can go out and kind of free and easy.
I'm amazed by how much the attitude in that world has changed. And obviously big things have happened, not just New York, but the size of their victories here in the Acela primary on Tuesday. But boy, it really, I mean, the whole attitude of, we don't really, we'll get there. We can lose a bunch of these states, no problem. California, we'll be, as long as we do okay there. There's just they know they're not going to get there until June 7th, but they really have a lot of confidence they're going to get there, like really a high degree of confidence, close to 100%, I'd say at this point.
Casey, where between, you know, the notion was Kasich says he's not going to campaign there. That opens up possibilities for Cruz. So much of the actions around Indianapolis, because that's where most of the congressional districts touch. Who are the targeted voters now between Cruz and Trump?
Well, Cruz is in a little bit of a difficult spot because he's got this natural kind of base in northeastern Indiana, religious conservatives, as you know. That's sort of been the backbone of his candidacy all the way along. The assumption is those voters are all going to be with him. Then you have some districts in the state that are also heavily manufacturing oriented. They've been really hit hard by the recession. You know, in previous cycles, those two groups of people might have voted the same way here in Indiana. But this time around, they're basically Trump voters. And what that leaves are these, you know, around, as you mentioned, Indianapolis, suburban, urban voters. I might call them Richard Lugar type Republicans. You know, these are people who are mostly moderate, who've been part of the, you know, party establishment. And it's pretty strong here in Indiana. It's been, you know, around a long time. And those are the people who are inclined to go for Kasich. And there are some who are strategic and they say, OK, fine, you know, I'm going to go to the ballot box. I'm going to vote for Ted Cruz. But there are a lot of them who just feel like they can't stomach that. And I've been hearing that sentiment. I'm just not convinced that Cruz is going to be able to get enough of those voters to actually make up the ground that he needs. I think that's what the Trump folks are counting on.
So let me raise a name with you, Mike Pence, who's a lot of people, all of these candidates who are left in the race would all love the endorsement of Governor Pence. What do you know about the Trump campaign's efforts to try to make that happen for them?
I know they've reached out to Governor Pence, and I know Donald Trump has had a meeting with him, a semi-positive meeting at least. I know that there are some things that the two of them have in common. Pence has been very outspoken when it comes to immigration. He's also been very outspoken on jobs leaving his state, Carrier, for instance, being one of those things. And Carrier has been something that Donald Trump has been hitting on the campaign trail for some time and something that's really resonated in a state like Indiana. Then again, Pence has a natural fit with Ted Cruz as well. He's very evangelical, very socially conservative. So there are reasons why he would go to either one of those candidates. I think what Donald Trump has going for him is the momentum and this feeling of inevitability. And I think that's what we're starting to see even today. I think more folks are going to come out and start endorsing him and embracing him once they realize that he's probably going to be the one who gets the nomination and they're going to want to get closer to the source of power.
Casey, you've been talking to people around Governor Pence. What do you hear out there in terms of the Pence primary?
Yeah. Well, Pence is in a little bit of a difficult spot. It's more solid as of late, but he's still kind of being cautious, you know, with an eye towards his own political fortunes. He also, you know, got in the middle of some really tough fights, that LGBT rights law, you know, around the NCAA, if you remember a year or two ago. And the reality is that for him, in many ways, getting involved in this is exactly the wrong thing. And really all he needed to do was be convinced, you know, not to endorse Cruz by the Trump folks. I think, you know, anyone who knows Pence, and I covered his, you know, brief presidential bid in 2012, knows that he lines up relatively well with Ted Cruz. It would seem natural. And the Republicans here definitely feel like if Pence put his finger on the scale in favor of Cruz, it would make a real difference. But as long as he stays on the sidelines, that's really all the Trump campaign needs.
So your gut says that Pence stays neutral in this, right?
I'm pretty sure that Pence is going to stay neutral. As Casey suggested, there's just no mileage in him in taking a position right now. Chris Christie was at that meeting with Trump and Pence, and I think Chris Christie made it clear to Mike Pence what he wanted to do, and they're pretty close and pretty strong political.
And Mitch Daniels also going to stay out of this, right? He's out of politics.
He's an academic. He doesn't do politics.
But it's funny, you know, I've told you earlier today, I was corresponding with a Rockford Republican friend of mine in Indiana who said the only person in the Republican Party, a Rockford Republican conservative, who said the only person he'd vote for would be Mitch Daniels if he could write him in. Daniels matters a lot still in that state if he were to lean one or the other, but he's not going to do that.
Casey, what is the formal Stop Trump movement that people like Club for Growth, Katie Packer's group, are they on the air? Are they contacting voters? How big a deal are they on the ground there?
They are on the air, and they say that they are contacting voters, but I have to say it's a little bit tough to kind of see their presence here, whereas, you know, I've definitely felt the impact just kind of watching TV, reading the local papers, talking to folks, that, you know, the Cruz super PAC and the Cruz campaign, you can feel both of their presences here, and you can definitely feel Trump's campaign. You know, they're up on the air with this ad featuring Don Jr. He's talking about Donald Trump's toughness in the ad, but it's showing pictures of Trump with his grandkids and saying, he's not actually that tough on the grandkids. A very clear effort to try to soften Trump's image. Women are a key issue here for them. And that's something that, you know, I bumped into without even really looking for it. And I think, you know, that tells you a little bit about the presence that they have here. I think it's a little bit firmer than people maybe would have thought. The Stop Trump forces, on the other hand, a little bit missing. I do know that there are some Stop Trump groups that are out in the field polling, so we should have some more information, you know, about where things have moved in the past couple of days, either tonight or early tomorrow.
Okay. Casey Hunt in Indianapolis, Katie Turr here in New York. Thank you both. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
We're going to keep this up with a different perspective. Republican strategist Steve Schmidt.
Oh, Schmidt.
Joins us when we come back.
Schmitty. We are hereby inaugurating a brand new branded segment of With All Due Respect. That segment is called Schmidt Happens. We're here with Republican strategist Steve Schmidt, who's the star of the ongoing series of the first installment, Schmidt Happens. Mr. Schmidt, you have some experience with vice presidential rollouts, famously in 2008. Just tell us about what you think, how you think the hypothetical vice presidential rollout of running mate rollout of Carly Fiorina was handled yesterday by Senator Cruz.
I think it was handled fine, but it's just not going to make much of a difference because his momentum in the campaign is stalled. It is what it is. He's trying to change the storyline from Trump's domination of these contests every Tuesday night. He's trying to get some energy into the campaign ahead of Indiana. So I think it went fine. But, you know, Carly Fiorina isn't a surprise. When they talked about, well, we're going to unveil the running mate, I think, you know, a lot of people who follow this stuff, you know, would have, you know, bet with not very long odds that, you know, it's likely to be Carly Fiorina. She's been road tested out there, you know, over the course of the last month. So, you know, at the end of the day, I think the net effect as a practical matter is a nothing burger as we wrap up this week and go into next week.
I thought one of the biggest things of the week, kind of overshadowed because so much has happened, was Tuesday night when Trump was asked, are you the presumptive nominee? And he said, yeah, I'm the presumptive nominee. He clearly wants those two guys out of the race.
He does.
If he wins Indiana and they don't get out, which I think is possible, what can he do? Are there people who could endorse? Are there what if Trump wanted to, and Manafort and Corey Lewandowski want to engineer that? What are some steps they could take to pressure them?
Well, the title of presumptive nominee is not one that is proclaimed; it's one that's bestowed, and it needs to be bestowed typically by the titular head of the party. So, in 2008, when it was clear that John McCain was going to be the presumptive nominee, he had a meeting with the President of the United States at the White House. In this case, the titular head of the party is either Mitt Romney, the past nominee, or it's Paul Ryan, the ranking elected Republican in the country, or perhaps it could be Reince Priebus. Right. But it's either some combination of Priebus, Ryan, and Mitt Romney saying the obvious, which is that Donald Trump is going to be the first ballot nominee of the Republican
Party.
Given
how contentious this whole thing has been and will continue to be in some quarters, is it possible that any of those three guys could or would say that or send that kind of signal until Trump actually goes numerically over him to a majority?
Well, I think certainly Reince Priebus and Speaker Ryan, there's no upside for the Speaker wanting to maintain control of the House and certainly for Leader McConnell in the Senate to damage unnecessarily the person who will be the nominee of the party. So piling on, denying the obvious when he is on the precipice of hitting that magic number of 1237 serves nobody's purpose.
So if he wins Indiana, could you imagine a world where Trump could call Reince Priebus and say, I'm getting this. You can read the abacus as well as I can. You should put out a statement, or you and I should meet, and you should send a signal that this thing's over. Is that
it would
a plausible
be totally,
gambit?
It would be totally appropriate for him to do so. I think Reince Priebus would go and check with, you know, a lot of his constituency, which is the membership of the Republican National Committee. But if you look at where Donald Trump is today, let's just say roughly, to make the math simple, he's at 1,000 delegates with the uncommitted in Pennsylvania. He's going to win New Jersey, winner take all. And let's be stingy in our allocation in California. And that we'll say he gets 150 out of the 172 in California. So he's at 1,200 pre-Indiana. If he wins Indiana, then he's clearly going to be the nominee on the first ballot in Cleveland, and the party should, you know, begin to bestow the trappings that it would on any nominee.
But the last time you were on this show, you talked about the fact that there were a lot of Republicans who privately think that Trump is unqualified, unsuited to be president, et cetera, right? So the Never Trump movement, regardless of whether he gets to 1237 or not, there are people who are in the Never Trump movement. Like, they're not going to vote for him, right? You're headed towards a Republican convention. You're Donald Trump. Mitt Romney doesn't show up at your convention. John McCain has said he's not going to show up at the convention. He could change his mind, but right now, the past two parties' nominees are not going to go. There are plenty of other leaders who have made it pretty clear that they will not ever vote for him, let alone stand up and endorse him. How do you manage that if you're?
Well,
I mean, some people are going to endorse him. He's going to get some endorsements. Some of the party's going to acquiesce and capitulate. But what do you do about that?
Once he becomes the nominee, we're gonna see the dissonance now between what people have been saying, which is never Trump, I'll never support Donald Trump, but I intend to support the nominee in my party.
Right.
And so that moment is, I think, quickly arriving, you know, and I think you will see some Republicans who say, no, I won't be able to support the nominee of the party. I think he is unfit.
Not a real conservative.
But I don't think that's going to be a majority. I think the prominent members of the elected leadership of the Republican Party, the number that won't support him, is going to be few and far between, because they're going to be, look, you have an elected class in Washington that was terrified of the Tea Party movement.
Right.
And it wasn't exactly profiles in courage standing up to some of the excesses over the last years among the elected Republican leadership. And the notion that these elected Republican congressmen or senators are going to take on the Trump constituency, you know, by going on and attacking Donald Trump when they haven't been willing to attack him while he's trying to get the nomination, after he becomes the clear nominee, I think is fanciful. I just don't think it's going to happen.
So does Mitt Romney go to the convention?
No, but
does John McCain go to the convention?
No, but John McCain can say, I'm running for re-election. I understand.
But how do you manage that piece of that dissonance? You know, if none of the past party nominees, the past president, George W. Bush, not going to be there, what do you do if you're Donald Trump and you're trying to bring the party together happens?
Bush and Cheney always seem to be busy during the convention,
right.
So they need to go.
But that's a lot of leaders.
If Trump wins on Tuesday, you're going to go back to all these people who've said, I'm not going to vote for Trump, but he's not going to be our nominee. Right. So once he's a nominee, then they face a choice. I think they're going to go about 80-20, 90-10 and say, look, he's our nominee. Bush 41, for instance, I think will have former party chairman. What's he going to do? Say he's not going to vote for the nominee of his own party?
Right.
Right? Once you get Bush 41, which I predict will happen relatively soon after Trump is the de facto nominee,
right,
then starting to lose people, if they don't show up in Cleveland and protest, what does it really matter, right?
Here's the other thing, is that once you're the nominee of your party, typically you indict all that's wrong in the world and in America completely on the other party.
Right.
So history begins for Republicans in this scenario on the moment that Barack Obama took office.
Right. Right.
Donald Trump's not like that. He's going to indict the failures of both parties, multiple administrations,
yeah,
going back to the 1980s.
That's not a recipe for party unity.
I think the last and arguably successful president, you know, that we had was Ronald Reagan in this country. Well, he's going to indict both parties, the leadership of both parties, and he's going to say there's upside to doing that with the millions of Democratic voters who are as upset as Republican voters that can cross over in that Reagan Democrat.
So you're basically saying that for him, by his calculation, party unity may be overrated. Because if you play that game, the game you're talking about him playing, that's a way to alienate large parts of the Republican Party. If you're basically making a bipartisan indictment that attacks both the Republican establishment and the Democratic establishment, you're going to have a lot of Republicans who aren't going to rally to that message.
I think you're likely to see him say, welcome aboard, want everybody on board, want everybody to be on the team, but he's not going to go out of his way to make enormous concessions. One of the things I think that he would be smart to do is to reach out to Paul Ryan upon winning Indiana, if he does that, and to say, what does the legislative package I send up to the Congress on January 21st look like? What does the first 100 days of legislation that you can pass, and I'd like you to partner with me in helping draft those right. legislative packages. That's how he does the reach out to establishment Republicans through Paul Ryan, through the policy operation. But granting the favor of the Washington lobbying class, the political establishment such as it is, it's not really important to him.
I said before I thought he'd get Bush 41. And he may get some others. Who are people that if you were Trump's team, you'd be worried about that they would follow Romney's course and say, I'm going to vote for Hillary or I'm going to write in or I'm going to sit out? Who are people who you think
be
might
worried about
who they might follow Romney's path that if you were Trump, you'd be concerned about?
What he wants to avoid is a critical mass of national security figures who are respected in
so if Petraeus, who he cites all the time, for instance, said he wouldn't vote for him.
General Petraeus or an Odierno
McChrystal.
Or Stan McChrystal, right. You know, the generals of our most recent wars. But even going back, Brent Scowcroft, Henry Kissinger, you know, foreign policy doyens of the last generation or
right.
so,
right.
if they raise a temperament issue, could be problematic.
Meet me at this camera. I'm telling you right now, in Brooklyn, they're going hard for many of the people on the list that Steve mentioned. The Clinton campaign is going to try to get endorsements from the very kind of people you're talking about early on to break Trump's back.
So we got 30 seconds. I just got to ask this question quick. Just coming right out of that, is it imperative that Trump put someone on the ticket with him who has national security experience?
It's not imperative, but he can send an important signal with who he picks to be the vice president. And I think it's absolutely blue skies, open space about what credentials that person's going to have that he gets on the ticket. You just have no idea. Is it going to be a governor? Is it going to be someone outside of politics? Is it going to be someone out of the military?
I think it's got to be someone with national security experience. I think it's the one thing that he just does not have that in his portfolio. And if he doesn't have that, it's going to be hard.
And there are going to be defections he's going to have to counterbalance.
Yes, correct.
Well, the key will be these debates in the fall. Yeah. We'll have three 90-minute debates. I think they'll be the most watched
global television
programs.
Oh my God.
You know, probably the most watched global program since the moon landing.
Yeah.
And Rhoda's
wedding.
And those will be right. determined. Right. We'll determine who the president is out of those. Yeah.
You are awesome. You are
Schmidt
what
happens.
You normally are. Right. So Schmidt just happened. That was some serious Schmidt that just happened. Man, it was awesome. Up next, we go down Washington way for a reporter roundtable. We'll preview the presidential contest in Indiana, California, and elsewhere after these quick words from our sponsors.
Joining us now, two people to speak truth to power on a regular basis. Phil Rucker of The Washington Post, who's in the Post newsroom, and Eliana Johnson, the Washington editor of The National Review, also in Washington in our bureau. Thank you both for joining us. Phil, as the week ends, who should be happier about how the week's gone? I know it's only Thursday, but Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton? Who's had having a better week so far?
You know, I'd say Hillary Clinton, only because it seems more certain that she'll be the nominee than Trump at this point, given all of the changes we've seen in the last 24 hours from the Sanders campaign. But Trump's had a really good week. He had some really crushing victories on Tuesday, and we're hearing more and more from Republicans out across the country, establishment figures, that they see him as the inevitable nominee, that this deal is basically almost done.
Ms. Johnson, very interesting article in Phil's paper today about how the Democrats are getting a big head start in some of the key battleground states, hiring staff, spending money, building up infrastructure. The Republican pushback didn't blow me away, but the RNC has argued for a while that they're building at least a little bit of a turnkey operation. How much behind do you think the Republicans actually are in thinking about a general election plan and building the infrastructure?
You know, I think the bigger factor on the Republican side, other than the infrastructure on the ground and the ground game, is going to be how enthusiastic people actually are about the ticket. And I think that's the real question mark, because you can have all the infrastructure and a ground game in the world, and if people aren't excited about their the ticket, they're not going to go out and vote. And I think there's a real question mark as to whether either of the potential tickets, either with Trump at the top or Cruz at the top, can generate sufficient enthusiasm among Republicans, conservatives, and independents to overtake Hillary Clinton in a general election.
Eliana, let me just stick with you. It seems to me that over the course of this week, you know, you've had Ted Cruz with this alliance, and then you had the Carly Fiorina announcement. You've had Kasich not messaging the alliance very well, and a lot of confusion between the two camps, and John Weaver now calling Ted Cruz a liar on Twitter. It just seems to me like utter chaos, like not only a desperate moment for the Stop Trump forces, but just totally rank incompetence unfolding left and right. Am I being overly harsh, or does it strike you the same way?
It's one big happy family, John. No, I think people have been generous in calling this a Stop Trump movement. It's been a series of independent efforts with no coordination from the outset. And to think that the candidates themselves, who are barely running campaigns on their own, would be able to do something together, I think, is too much to ask. But there really hasn't been a coherent Stop Trump movement with any sort of strategy at all. It's just been independently organized efforts that haven't worked together. And when they have, as in Wisconsin, it's really by accident.
Phil, I'm going to ask you about the Democrats, because I saw a very good piece that you just published in which the headline reads in the Post, Clinton is the insider who's surviving in the year of the outsider. It is clearly the year of the outsider, yeah. And yet Hillary Clinton is clearly surviving. So just explain that. How exactly is that the case? She's the ultimate insider, and yet she's survived so far in this year of the ultimate year of the outsider.
That's right. Well, all year long in both parties, we've seen this anti-establishment anger, this outsider energy take shape in the grassroots. And what Hillary Clinton has been able to do is convince Democrats that they may be angry, but they're angry at institutions outside of government. They're angry at the big banks. They're angry at corporations. They're angry at what they see as inherent unfairness in the economic system. But they have not lost faith in their elected leaders. They still support Barack Obama. These are Democratic voters, of course. And she's saying to them, look, I have the experience and I can make change from within the system. That's totally different from what we see on the Republican side, which is more of a full-out revolt. We see people, a lot of voters losing faith, not only with the system, but with the leadership in the system. And that's why you see this support for Donald Trump and Ted Cruz, both of whom are these totally outside figures who want to blow the whole thing up.
Less than a minute to go. Either of you like to sing anything at this point, or you'll pass on that?
I'm deferring to Phil on that.
Yeah. You wrote a very nice explanation of how Ted Cruz came to settle on Carly Fiorina. Less than 30 seconds to go. Just explain what you think kind of the match was in his mind.
Well, I think they have a real intellectual connection. She's an incredibly smart woman, but that the thing that really sealed the deal for them was that she's an incredibly effective attack dog. And Cruz, because he's alienated so many people in Washington, hasn't connected with somebody who could really go out and defend him strongly. And that's what Carly has done for him and brought to the ticket.
Nice to have your own personal attack dog if you're trying to get elected president. Eliana Johnson and Phil Rucker, thank you both again. Both of them have great pieces up on their respective websites at this hour.
Neither of them remotely looks like Lucifer in the flesh.
And neither wanted to sing. Sing us to break. Go ahead. All right. Up next, thank you both. Who's winning the Indiana ad war? We'll look at the data. And if you like our last guests, you're watching us from Washington, D.C., you can also listen to us on the radio at Bloomberg 99.1 FM. And we will be right back.
So John Kasich not spending money on the airwaves in Indiana, but his rivals Donald Trump and Ted Cruz and a whole gaggle of super PACs are all taking no chances ahead of the primary there next week on the Republican side. The same goes on the Democratic side for Bernie Sanders, who's currently outspending Hillary Clinton in the Hoosier state. For this week's By the Numbers segment, we called in our ad man maestro, Ken Goldstein, to give us an update on the media wars and this particular point in this particular state in the Midwest.
Well, a lot of people think of my father as a tough guy.
It's the latest Trump ad.
My father will make an incredible president.
So far, playing over 200 times in Indiana. The billionaire paying $46,000 on the buy.
They just don't get it. Ted Cruz does.
It's part of a last-minute burst in Hoosier ads, tallying over $8.1 million so far. But once again, the front runners aren't the ones buying big.
Bernie Sanders, people before polluters.
The Sanders camp may be laying off staffers, but they are spending over $2 million on TV and radio in Indiana. The Clinton camp, nothing on air there, and zero in the pipeline.
Trump scammed students. He'll scam America, too.
The anti-Trump, pro-Cruz, Fiorina forces are shelling out $5 million in Indiana. Trump, just a meager million. Zooming out nationally, it's right in line with this cycle's upside-down trend. The front runners spending much less than their opponents. Of the $442 million shelled out on radio and TV ads so far in this race, first-place Trump has only chipped in $21 million, $12 million less than Ted Cruz and his allies, while Hillary Clinton has spent $15 million less than Bernie Sanders.
So it cannot be said enough times that this race has confounded expectations. A lot of money has been raised, a lot's been spent, but anybody, the expectations for how money would play and who it would help and who it would hurt have been kind of obliterated to a large extent by what we've seen over the last year.
Yeah, I mean, look, Ken does a great job of tracking this stuff, but he would agree that the earned media makes such a big difference. What has worked for Sanders when it's worked with these ads is when they dovetail with what he's doing out in the stuff.
Sure.
That ad with Simon Garfunkel was with America was great, yeah. But at the time it was dovetailing with kind of the momentum he felt.
Coming into Iowa, coming out of Iowa.
And the contrast with Hillary Clinton's smaller events and his larger events. And also it allowed him to start seeming more like an optimistic candidate rather than kind of the negative rhetoric he sometimes has.
Yeah.
I think that Trump is going to be able to win this without a serious change in media. But paid media in the general will matter, and he's going to need to find the money to do it.
It matters for sure, at least to provide air cover. But I got to say, all that money on the Republican side, all those candidates, all those super PACs, there's not a single memorable Republican ad. There's not an ad I could cite sitting here right now that I thought was a memorable piece of creative that I thought actually moved the needle in any primary or caucus state. Not one.
And the dirty little secret right now,
not
about
one.
The Kasich campaign, to a large extent, a little bit Cruz, is they don't have a lot of money.
All right. Our thanks again to the great Ken Goldstein. He is great, too, and we'll be right back.
Check out our campaign tracker on BloombergPolitics.com for all the latest 2016 information, including a great story by James Nash and Allison Vexen on San Francisco Republicans being courted ahead of the upcoming California primary. And coming up on Bloomberg TV, Emily Chang sits down with Twitter co-founder Biz Stone.
Oh, I love that guy.
See you tomorrow. Sayonara. Welcome back. Joining us now, MSNBC reporter on the Stop Trump beat, Casey Hunt, who joins us from Indianapolis, and Katie Turr, NBC News reporter covering Donald Trump here in the studio. Ladies, thank you for joining us. Casey, there's been very little polling in Indiana on the Republican side. You've been out there for a while. What's your sense from talking to folks about where Trump stands vis-a-vis Cruz in advance of Tuesday?
Hi, guys. Yeah, the people that I've been talking to on the ground here over the course of the last couple of days basically say that there was some data they were looking at early in the week, of course, you know, kind of internal polling stuff the party was doing, that showed Trump actually on the rise. And of course, that was before those big victories early in the week. And before, of course, Cruz stepped in it a little bit, called it a basketball ring. So people I've talked to are a little skeptical that he's going to be able to pull this out against Donald Trump. And there's a sense on the ground that there are a combination of things that are sort of limiting Cruz at this point. You guys were talking a little bit earlier in the show about Carly Fiorina. I definitely think you're right about the lack of wow factor here. That was something else I've been hearing.
Katie, my interactions with the Trump folks since Tuesday have been led me to believe that they feel pretty confident about Indiana. What's your sense?
Same thing. I've spoken to senior aides, and they believe that they have an advantage in Indiana because they went on the air a week before Ted Cruz did.
And there's been early voting going on.
Exactly, and they haven't quite spent as much money, so they tout that as well. But I don't think they feel like they need Indiana as much as they might have needed it if they had not come out of the five states on Tuesday with such a strong delegate, especially when it comes to those unbound delegates in Pennsylvania. So I think they're feeling confident. I think Indiana would be the cherry on top of their sundae, but it's not something that they're necessarily banking
on. It's almost as if they're liberated, John, that they don't need to win it, and therefore they can go out and kind of free and easy.
I'm amazed by how much the attitude in that world has changed. And obviously big things have happened, not just New York, but the size of their victories here in the Acela primary on Tuesday. But boy, it really, I mean, the whole attitude of, we don't really, we'll get there. We can lose a bunch of these states, no problem. California, we'll, as long as we do okay there, there's just they know they're not going to get there until June 7th, but they really have a lot of confidence they're going to get there, like really high degree of confidence, close to 100%, I'd say at this point.
Casey, where between, you know, the notion was Kasich says he's not going to campaign there. That opens up possibilities for Cruz. So much of the actions around Indianapolis, because that's where most of the congressional districts touch. Who are the targeted voters now between Cruz and Trump?
Well, Cruz is in a little bit of a difficult spot because he's got this natural kind of base in northeastern Indiana, religious conservatives, as you know, that's sort of been the backbone of his candidacy all the way along. The assumption is those voters are all going to be with him. Then you have some districts in the state that are also heavily manufacturing oriented. They've been really hit hard by the recession. You know, in previous cycles, those two groups of people might have voted the same way here in Indiana, but this time around, they're basically Trump voters. And what that leaves are these, you know, around, as you mentioned, Indianapolis, suburban, urban voters. I might call them Richard Lugar type Republicans. You know, these are people who are mostly moderate, who've been part of the, you know, party establishment, and it's pretty strong here in Indiana. It's been, you know, around a long time, and those are the people who are inclined to go for Kasich, and there are some who are strategic, and they say, okay, fine, you know, I'm going to go to the ballot box, I'm going to vote for Ted Cruz, but there are a lot of them who just feel like they can't stomach that, and I've been hearing that sentiment. I'm just not convinced that Cruz is going to be able to get enough of those voters to actually make up the ground that he needs. I think that's what the Trump folks are counting on.
So let me raise a name with you, Mike Pence, who's a lot of people, all of these candidates who are left in the race would all love the endorsement of Governor Pence. What do you know about the Trump campaign's efforts to try to make that happen for them?
I know they've reached out to Governor Pence, and I know Donald Trump has had a meeting with him, a semi-positive meeting at least. I know that there are some things that the two of them have in common. Pence has been very outspoken when it comes to immigration. He's also been very outspoken on jobs leaving his state, Carrier, for instance, being one of those things. And Carrier has been something that Donald Trump has been hitting on the campaign trail for some time and something that's really resonated in a state like Indiana. Then again, Pence has a natural fit with Ted Cruz as well. He's very evangelical, very socially conservative. So there are reasons why he would go to either one of those candidates. I think what Donald Trump has going for him is the momentum and this feeling of inevitability. And I think that's what we're starting to see even today. I think more folks are going to come out and start endorsing him and embracing him once they realize that he's probably going to be the one who gets the nomination and they're going to want to get closer to the source of power.
Casey, you've been talking to people around Governor Pence. What do you hear out there in terms of the Pence primary?
Yeah. Well, Pence is in a little bit of a difficult spot. It's more solid as of late, but he's still kind of being cautious, you know, with an eye towards his own political fortunes. He also, you know, got in the middle of some really tough fights, that LGBT rights law, you know, around the NCAA, if you remember a year or two ago. And the reality is that for him, in many ways, getting involved in this is exactly the wrong thing. And really all he needed to do was be convinced, you know, not to endorse Cruz by the Trump folks. I think, you know, anyone who knows Pence, and I covered his, you know, brief presidential bid in 2012, knows that he lines up relatively well with Ted Cruz. It would seem natural. And the Republicans here definitely feel like if Pence put his finger on the scale in favor of Cruz, it would make a real difference. But as long as he stays on the sidelines, that's really all the Trump campaign needs.
So your gut says that Pence stays neutral in this, right?
I'm pretty sure that Pence is going to stay neutral. As Casey suggested, there's just no mileage in him in taking a position right now. Chris Christie was at that meeting with Trump and Pence, and I think Chris Christie made it clear to Mike Pence what he wanted to do, and they're pretty close and pretty strong politically.
And Mitch Daniels also going to stay out of this, right? He's out of politics.
He's an academic. He doesn't do politics.
But it's funny, you know, I told you earlier today, I was corresponding with a Rockford Republican friend of mine in Indiana who said the only person in the Republican Party, a Rockford Republican conservative, who said the only person he'd vote for would be Mitch Daniels if he could write him in. Daniels matters a lot still in that state. He were to lean one or the other, but he's not going to do that.
Casey, what is the formal Stop Trump movement that people like Club for Growth, Katie Packer's group, are they on the air? Are they contacting voters? How big a deal are they on the ground there?
They are on the air, and they say that they are contacting voters, but I have to say it's a little bit tough to kind of see their presence here, whereas, you know, I've definitely felt the impact just kind of watching TV, reading the local papers, talking to folks, that, you know, the Cruz Super PAC and the Cruz campaign, you can feel both of their presences here, and you can definitely feel Trump's campaign. You know, they're up on the air with this ad featuring Don Jr. He's talking about Donald Trump's toughness in the ad, but it's...
I'm Mark Halperin.
And I'm John Heilemann. And with all due respect to John Boehner, so, a fleshy Lucifer, huh?
Ted Cruz is Lucifer in the flesh.
John Boehner, in a public appearance, calling Ted Cruz, quote,
Lucifer in the flesh.
Lucifer in the flesh.
Lucifer in the flesh.
Night of the Living Ted, demonology fans, on the show tonight. God, that music is really spooky. Carly's deal with the devil, Indiana's Judgment Day, and the Stop Trump folks try one last exorcism. But first, the cult of Donald Trump's machismo. Over the past 24 hours, the Republican frontrunner has been doubling down on his testosterone don image. And yes, I know I'm misspelling it. We know we're mispronouncing it. You must have some respect for poetry, people. In an interview with the Today Show this morning, Trump repeated his claim that Hillary Clinton would not be a viable presidential candidate or even a city council candidate if she weren't playing the, quote, woman card, end quote. And this afternoon, Trump and his campaign pushed that tough guy tone even further at a rally at Elkhart, Indiana, with the legendary basketball coach and ranter, Bobby Knight.
You know, Bobby called me up. He called me up about a year ago, and he said to me, hey, Donald, I don't know him. I didn't know him. I knew of him. He was, to me, the best. You don't get any better. Tough, tough. Would you say he was tough enough? Would you say? But, you know, not just tough. Smart, tactical. He was a winner. He was a winner and still is a winner. Believe me, the best.
Let me first tell you that I was very, very selective with players during the time I was here. And I'll tell you one thing, that man that was just up here a moment ago, I'll tell you, that son of a bitch could play for me.
That son of a bitch. All right. Trump's campaign also has a new TV ad up in Indiana featuring Donald Trump Jr. talking again about how tough, tough, tough his dad is. So, Mark, this testosterone don thing, smart, dumb, somewhere in between.
Somewhere in between. I think it needs to be calibrated. That ad running in Indiana with Donald Trump Jr. also includes a little flash of Donald Trump Sr. playing with his grandkids. So they're recognized that they need to soften him a little bit. This is the quintessence of letting Trump be Trump. This is the kind of personality he has. It plays to his strength. Clearly, at some point, some women might find this appealing. Clearly, at some point, I think they need to use Ivanka and Mrs. Trump and others to round it out. But this is him. He doesn't back down. He believes what he said about Hillary Clinton. May not work, but I think when they try to make him back down or when they try to sand off the rough edges, it's not going to work. He's going to win or lose as machismo.
Well, that's great. Fabulous. You know, I said yesterday on our show that Donald Trump has a huge problem with women voters. If he doesn't solve that problem, he can't be president of the United States. So he can be him if he wants to be, if he wants to continue down this path and continue. I don't think anything he did in these instances is offensive, but he is going to have to do something to remediate this problem in some substantial degree. You know, maybe he'll do it later, maybe he'll do it now. But I remember a guy named Mitt Romney in 2012 who just refused to defend Bain, who refused to do, in the face of all the assaults from the Obama campaign. He stuck to his principles, too, and he got eviscerated. So I think Trump needs to fix this problem.
There are tens of millions of Americans who love Hillary Clinton. They love her personality. They love what she stands for. They love the prospect of her being president. But there are tens of millions of American women who don't feel that way.
I agree.
And is Trump's route to them this way, or is it some more nuanced thing? I think it's a combination, but I'll say again, any other campaign, they would not have followed yesterday or Tuesday night's remark with this kind of display.
Right.
But this is what Trump is about. This is what he's like.
And you don't need to be clear. When I say he needs to fix this problem, I don't mean he has to like swing 180 degrees in some other direction and do all kinds of pandering things to women. That's not the point. And again, to also be clear, I don't think anything he did this day was offensive. I just think there's still a lot of like there is this sense of like we're going to be tough. We're not going to back down. I'm not going to ever admit a mistake. I'm never going to even sand off a little bit of a rough edge. I'm just not sure that's smart.
And back to Reagan, the press obsesses about the gender gap only in one direction. Trump's going to do very well with men, and Hillary Clinton has to worry about that to some extent if they face each other in the general. All right, now it is our turn to say it. Lucifer in the flesh. That's the political phrase of the day.
I should have said it with you.
And what former Speaker of the House John Boehner, a Republican, called Ted Cruz last night in an event in California at Stanford University. That reminds us all just how much some denizens of Capitol Hill dislike intensely the gentleman from Texas. According to the respected Stanford Daily, while Boehner called himself and Donald Trump, quote, texting buddies who have golfed together in the past, former speaker did not hold back his feelings about Cruz. He said also, quote, I have Democrat friends and Republican friends. I get along with almost everyone, but I have never worked with a more miserable son of a bitch in my life, speaking about Ted Cruz. Here's how Cruz responded to all this at an event this morning in Fort Wayne, Indiana.
When John Boehner calls me Lucifer, he's not directing that at me. He's directing that at you. What Boehner is angry with me for is not anything I've ever said to him. I haven't said much of anything. What Boehner is angry with me for is standing with the American people, is energizing and encouraging House conservatives to stand with the American people and actually honor the commitments we've made.
All right, so this spat comes at a pretty pivotal moment for the Republican Party. The central question in the nomination race right now is whether the balance of power in the GOP is becoming increasingly resigned to coalescing around Trump as their candidate for the fall, or if the Stop Trump faction can hold its ground and maybe grow before Trump can sew up the nomination. Their small sign today of which way this pivotal tug of war is going. Trump got another congressional endorsement. He hasn't gotten many. This one from Pennsylvania Congressman Bill Schuster. Meanwhile, the already fragile alliance between Ted Cruz and John Kasich, key to any success that the Stop Trump movement might have, seems to be fraying even more. When asked about the alliance in Fort Wayne today, Cruz denied there ever was collusion between the two campaigns, immediately after which Kasich's top strategist, John Weaver, tweeted, quote, I can't stand liars. All right, so, John, the Indiana
primary. Tone? You would say that.
I read tone into the tweet. Indiana primaries Tuesday.
Yeah.
As you look within Indiana and nationally, is the Stop Trump movement growing or shrinking?
Well, I don't know that it's shrinking, but it seems to me that there are a lot of people who are in neither the Stop Trump movement nor in the
Fanciful. I just don't think it's going
to
happen.
So does Mitt Romney go to the convention?
No, but
does John McCain go to the convention?
No, but John McCain can say I'm running for re-election. I understand.
But how do you manage that piece of that dissonance? You know, if none of the past party nominees, the past president George W. Bush, not going to be there, what do you do if you're Donald Trump and you're trying to bring the party together?
Bush, Bush and Cheney always seem to be busy during the convention,
right.
So they need to go.
But that's a lot of leaders.
If Trump wins on Tuesday, you're going to go back to all. We're going to go back to all these people who've said, I'm not going to vote for Trump, but he's not going to be our nominee. Right. So once he's a nominee, then they face a choice. I think they're going to go about 80-20, 90-10 and say, look, he's our nominee. Bush 41, for instance, I think will have former party chairman. What's he going to do? Say he's not going to vote for the nominee of his own party?
Right.
Right. Once you get Bush 41, which I predict will happen relatively soon after Trump is the de facto nominee.
Right.
Then starting to lose people. If they don't show up in Cleveland and protest, what does it really matter? Right.
Here's the other thing is that once you're the nominee of your party, typically you indict all that's wrong in the world and in America completely on the other party.
Right.
So history begins for Republicans in this scenario on the moment that Barack Obama took office.
Right. Right.
Donald Trump's not like that. He's going to indict the failures of both parties, multiple administrations,
yeah,
going back to the 1980s.
That's not arresting for party unity.
I think the last and arguably successful president, you know, that we had was Ronald Reagan in this country. Well, he's going to indict both parties, the leadership of both parties, and he's going to say there's upside to doing that with the millions of Democratic voters who are as upset as Republican voters that can cross over in that Reagan Democrat.
So you're basically saying that for him, by his calculation, party unity may be overrated. Because if you play that game, the game you're talking about him playing, that's a way to alienate large parts of the Republican Party. If you're basically making a bipartisan indictment that attacks both the Republican establishment and the Democratic establishment, you're going to have a lot of Republicans who aren't going to rally to that message.
I think you're likely to see him say, welcome aboard, want everybody on board, want everybody to be on the team, but he's not going to go out of his way to make enormous concessions. One of the things I think that he would be smart to do is to reach out to Paul Ryan upon winning Indiana, if he does that, and to say, what does the legislative package I send up to the Congress on January 21st look like? What does the first 100 days of legislation that you can pass? And I'd like you to partner with me in helping draft those right. legislative packages. That's how he does the reach out to establishment Republicans through Paul Ryan, through the policy operation. But granting the favor of the Washington, getting the favor of the Washington lobbying class, the political establishment such as it is, it's not really important to
him. I said before I thought he'd get Bush 41. And he may get some others. Who are people that if you were Trump's team, you'd be worried about that they would follow Romney's course and say, I'm going to vote for Hillary or I'm going to write in or I'm going to sit out? Who are people who you think
be
might
worried about
who they might follow Romney's path that if you were Trump, you'd be concerned about?
What he wants to avoid is a critical mass of national security figures who are respected in
so if Petraeus, who he cites all the time, for instance, said he wouldn't vote for him.
General Petraeus or an Odierno
McChrystal,
or Stan McChrystal, right. You know, the generals of our most recent wars. But even going back, Brent Scowcroft, Henry Kissinger, you know, foreign policy doyens of the last generation or
right.
so,
right.
if they raise a temperament issue, could be problematic.
Meet me at this camera. I'm telling you right now, in Brooklyn, they're going hard for many of the people on the list that Steve mentioned. The Clinton campaign is going to try to get endorsements from the very kind of people you're talking about early on to break Trump's back.
So we got 30 seconds. I just got to ask this question quick, just coming right out of that. Is it imperative that Trump put someone on the ticket with him who has national security experience?
It's not imperative, but he can send an important signal with who he picks to be the vice president. And I think it's absolutely blue skies, open space about what credentials that person is going to have that he goes on the ticket. You just have no idea. Is it going to be a governor? Is it going to be someone outside of politics? Is it going to be someone out of the military?
I think it's got to be someone with national security experience. I think it's the one thing that he just does not have that in his portfolio. And if he doesn't have that, it's going to be hard.
And there are going to be defections he's going to have to counterbalance.
Yes, correct.
Well, the key will be these debates in the fall. Yeah. We'll have 3 90-minute debates. I think they'll be the most watched global television programs.
Oh my God.
You know, probably the most watched global program since the moon landing.
Yeah.
And Rhoda's wedding. And those will be right. determined. Right. We'll determine who the president is out of those. Yeah.
You are awesome. You are
Schmidt
what
happens.
You normally are. Right. So Schmidt just happened. That was some serious Schmidt that just happened. Man, it was awesome. Up next, we go down Washington way for a reporter roundtable. We'll preview the presidential contest in Indiana, California, and elsewhere after these quick words from our sponsors.
now two people to speak truth to power on a regular basis. Phil Rucker of The Washington Post, who's in the Post newsroom, and Eliana Johnson, the Washington editor of The National Review, also in Washington in our bureau. Thank you both for joining us. Phil, as the week ends, who should be happier about how the week's gone? I know it's only Thursday, but Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton? Who's having a better week so far?
You know, I'd say Hillary Clinton, only because it seems more certain that she'll be the nominee than Trump at this point, given all of the changes we've seen in the last 24 hours from the Sanders campaign. But Trump's had a really good week. He had some really crushing victories on Tuesday, and we're hearing more and more from Republicans out across the country, establishment figures, that they see him as the inevitable nominee, that this deal is basically almost done.
Ms. Johnson, very interesting article in Phil's paper today about how the Democrats are getting a big head start in some of the key battleground states, hiring staff, spending money, building up infrastructure. The Republican pushback didn't blow me away, but the RNC has argued for a while that they're building at least a little bit of a turnkey operation. How much behind do you think the Republicans actually are in thinking about a general election plan and building the infrastructure?
You know, I think the bigger factor on the Republican side, other than the infrastructure on the ground and the ground game, is going to be how enthusiastic people actually are about the ticket. And I think that's the real question mark, because you can have all the infrastructure and a ground game in the world.
Showing pictures of Trump with his grandkids and saying, he's not actually that tough on the grandkids, a very clear effort to try to soften Trump's image. Women are a key issue here for them. And that's something that, you know, I bumped into without even really looking for it. And I think, you know, that tells you a little bit about the presence that they have here. I think it's a little bit firmer than people maybe would have thought. The Stop Trump forces, on the other hand, a little bit missing. I do know that there are some Stop Trump groups that are out in the field polling, so we should have some more information, you know, about where things have moved in the past couple of days, either tonight or early tomorrow.
Okay. Casey Hunt in Indianapolis, Katie Turr here in New York. Thank you both. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
We're going to keep this up with a different perspective. Republican strategist Steve Schmidt.
Oh, Schmidt.
Joins us when we come back.
Schmitty. We are hereby inaugurating a brand new branded segment of With All Due Respect. That segment is called Schmidt Happens. We're here with Republican strategist Steve Schmidt, who's the star of the ongoing series of just the first installment, Schmidt Happens. Mr. Schmidt, you have some experience with vice presidential rollouts, famously in 2008. Mm-hmm. Just tell us about what you think, how you think the hypothetical vice presidential rollout of running mate rollout of Carly Fiorina was handled yesterday by Senator Cruz.
I think it was handled fine, but it's just not going to make much of a difference because his momentum in the campaign is stalled. It is what it is. He's trying to change the storyline from Trump's domination of these contests every Tuesday night. He's trying to get some energy into the campaign ahead of Indiana. So I think it went fine. But, you know, Carly Fiorina isn't a surprise when they talked about, well, we're going to unveil the running mate. I think, you know, a lot of people who follow this stuff, you know, would have, you know, bet with not very long odds that, you know, it's likely to be Carly Fiorina. She's been road tested out there, you know, over the course of the last month. So, you know, at the end of the day, I think the net effect as a practical matter is a nothing burger as we wrap up this week and go into next week.
I thought one of the biggest things of the week, kind of overshadowed because so much has happened, was Tuesday night when Trump was asked, are you the presumptive nominee? And he said, yeah, I'm the presumptive nominee. He clearly wants those two guys out of the race.
He does.
If he wins Indiana and they don't get out, which I think is possible, what can he do? Are there people who could endorse? Are there what if Trump wanted to, and Manafort and Corey Lewandowski want to engineer that? What are some steps they could take to pressure them?
Well, the title of presumptive nominee is not one that is proclaimed. It's one that's bestowed, and it needs to be bestowed typically by the titular head of the party. So in 2008, when it was clear that John McCain was going to be the presumptive nominee, he had a meeting with the President of the United States at the White House. In this case, the titular head of the party is either Mitt Romney, the past nominee, or it's Paul Ryan, the ranking elected Republican in the country, or perhaps it could be Reince Priebus. Right. But it's either some combination of Priebus, Ryan, and Mitt Romney saying the obvious, which is that Donald Trump is going to be the first ballot nominee of the Republican
Party. Given how
Party.
Contentious this whole thing has been and will continue to be in some right. quarters, is it possible that any of those three guys could or would say that or send that kind of signal until Trump actually goes numerically over him to a majority?
Well, I think certainly Reince Priebus and Speaker Ryan, there's no upside for the Speaker wanting to maintain control of the House and certainly for Leader McConnell in the Senate to damage unnecessarily the person who will be the nominee of the party. So piling on, denying the obvious when he is on the precipice of hitting that magic number of 1237 serves nobody's purpose.
So if he wins Indiana, could you imagine a world where Trump could call Reince Priebus and say, I'm getting this. You can read the abacus as well as I can. You should put out a statement, or you and I should meet, and you should send the signal that this thing's over. Is that
it would
a plausible
be totally,
gambit?
It would be totally appropriate for him to do so. I think Reince Priebus would go and check with, you know, a lot of his constituency, which is the membership of the Republican National Committee. Right. But if you look at where Donald Trump is today, let's just say roughly, to make the math simple, he's at 1,000 delegates with the uncommitted in Pennsylvania. He's going to win New Jersey, winner take all. And let's say, let's be stingy in our allocation in California. And that we'll say he gets 150 out of the 172 in California. So he's at 1,200 pre-Indiana. If he wins Indiana, then he's clearly going to be the nominee right. on the first ballot in Cleveland, and the party should, you know, begin to bestow the trappings that it would on any nominee.
But the last time you were on this show, you talked about the fact that there were a lot of Republicans who privately think
right.
that Trump is unqualified, unsuited to be president, right. Et cetera, right? So the Never Trump movement, regardless of whether he gets to 1237 or not, there are people who are in the Never Trump movement. Like, they're not going to vote for him, right? You're headed towards a Republican convention. You're Donald Trump. Mitt Romney doesn't show up at your convention. John McCain has said he's not going to show up at the convention. He could change his mind. But right now, the past two parties' nominees are not going to go. There are plenty of other leaders who have made it pretty clear that they will not ever vote for him, let alone stand up and endorse him. How do you manage that if you're
what?
I mean, some people are going to endorse him. He's going to get some endorsements. Some of the party's going to acquiesce and capitulate. But what do you do about that?
Once he becomes the nominee, we're gonna see the dissonance now between what people have been saying, which is never Trump, I'll never support Donald Trump, but I intend to support the nominee of my party.
Right.
And so that moment is, I think, quickly arriving, you know, and I think you will see some Republicans who say, no, I won't be able to support the nominee of the party. I think he is unfit.
Not a Republican,
but
not a real Republican, not a real conservative.
But I don't think that's going to be a majority. I think the prominent members of the elected leadership of the Republican Party, the number that won't support him is going to be few and far between, because they're going to be, look, you have an elected class in Washington that was terrified of the Tea Party movement.
Right.
And it wasn't exactly profiles in courage standing up to some of the excesses over the last years among the elected Republican leadership. And the notion that these elected Republican congressmen or senators are going to take on the Trump constituency, you know, by going on and attacking Donald Trump when they haven't been willing to attack him while he's trying to get the nomination, after he becomes the clear nominee, I think it's
pro-Trump movement, people who have been holding their fire slowly, gradually, and maybe there'll be a lot more after Indiana if Donald Trump wins. But right now, there's a small trickle going into the pro-Trump or the Trump acquiescence, Trump capitulation side. And that's bad news for the Stop Trump movement, because the Stop Trump movement is static and it's not being particularly effective,
yeah.
which is the key thing.
It has to grow to stop him, because at its current size, it's not done much to slow him down, Wisconsin being the big exception. You saw today the governor of Florida once again saying we got to get behind Trump, another congressional endorsement. But everything I'm hearing is there are a lot of people who are poised to give up and throw in the towel after Tuesday if Trump wins Indiana.
Could be true. But I will say one of the things that all of this has pointed out, the Boehner comments about Cruz, the back and forth between Weaver, this Stop Trump movement, it's going to be hard to stop him. this group is so ragtag and so ineffective and ham-handed, the group that is now represented the face of the Stop Trump movement, Ted Cruz and John Kasich. Kasich has performed miserably, and Cruz is incredibly disliked. And the Boehner thing points that out. It's never been far from the surface, but he's the worst possible person to be the standard bearer for trying to stop a locomotive-like freight train of a front runner.
Yep, and Hillary Clinton, John Boehner like Hillary Clinton, and Boehner also said some nice things about Hillary Clinton. Yep. They like interesting personalities. Donald Trump is a likable, interesting personality to a lot of people. And Ted Cruz
is not,
not so much.
Not so much to a lot of people. Right.
But not to everybody.
Not to everybody. His wife likes him a lot. All right. When we come back, our review of Carla Fiorina's first full day as Ted Cruz's running mate, how she's doing, and more after this quick break.
As most of you will certainly note in your journals, today was Carla Fiorina's first full day as a hypothetical vice presidential candidate. She did a round robin of television interviews this morning, plus three events in the Hoosier State with Ted Cruz attacking Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and talking up her new BFF / running mate, Ted Cruz. Here's a representative sampling of some of the things she said.
Hillary Clinton's made her millions selling access and influence, and Donald Trump has made his billions buying people like Hillary Clinton off. They will not fight the system, although they claim to do so to win a job that they aspire to. They are the system.
It works for people like Donald Trump. He's big and powerful and wealthy and well-connected, but it doesn't work for most of us. And so what you have here is a fearless fighter who, as a conservative, understands that the thing that ails us is too much money and too much power concentrated in the hands of too few.
All right, the Cruz campaign is also featuring Fiorina in a new television ad. It's going up on the air in Indiana, complete with this distinct, amusing ending.
I'm Ted Cruz.
I'm Carly Fiorina.
And we approve this message.
Adorable. All right. So, John, how is Carly Fiorina doing so far as Ted Cruz's hypothetical running mate?
She has, as far as I can see, having watched these interviews and seen how she's performed, she's doing about as well as she did as a presidential candidate, which is to say she's not really leaving much of a mark. She's not doing anything to my mind. I thought yesterday she's mostly going to be a wash. I don't think she's going to hurt him in Indiana. I don't think she's going to help him very much. There's nothing that she's done this morning in terms of these interviews that I've seen that changes my calculation about how much I think she's going to help or hurt, which is like basically zip.
All running mate combos are symbolic and stagecraft. There's no substance here, right? So I'd still think that the fact that they campaigned together so much, the fact that they telegraphed this pick for days, it's really taken the wow factor out of it.
Yeah.
If they had not campaigned together, if they hadn't telegraphed it, I think this thing would have more of an impact. Carla Fiorina doing cable interviews and introducing Ted Cruz at events, been
big
there,
deal.
Seen there,
big
done,
deal.
Seen this, done that.
For weeks before.
So I think it's helping. I think it's energizing the Cruz campaign. It's giving them something to talk about, but it's not transforming the race, which you could have imagined picks that would have transformed the race.
Well, and look, that's one of my issues here is that, like, if you're going to throw a Hail Mary pass, throw a Hail Mary pass. This isn't a Hail Mary.
Right.
This is like a medium length pass down the field. Like, put somebody on the ticket who really would have shocked the world, some woman of some prominence who we all would have been really genuinely surprised by, who would have been a real game changer, to coin a phrase.
Like Julia Childs or
something. Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
You know,
I don't know.
Take your sports metaphor. They threw a Hail Mary. They completed it, but they're still down 30 points.
Yes, well, and they're still 20 yards short of the goal line.
Yeah.
It's just not going to – and I think she's going to – and somebody has to have to ask her a lot of questions about outsourcing eventually, and that's not going to be pretty in Indiana. Okay, so Bernie Sanders and his team, they're sending out some mixed signals about the future of his campaign, again, not for the first time, and what it hopes to accomplish following that bruising defeat in 4 out of 5 states on Tuesday. Yesterday, as we mentioned on the show, the New York Times reported that the campaign, Sanders' campaign that is laying off a couple hundred staff members across the country and refocusing its resources on California, which votes on June 7. And yet, Bernie's wife, Jane, was out on the cable shows today saying unequivocally that her husband is, quote, absolutely in it to win, end quote. Fundraising, never been a problem for Bernie Sanders, quite the contrary. He reportedly has more than $17 million sitting in his bank account. So, Mark, my question for you, given all that dough. Why is Sanders laying off staff? What's necessary? What does that mean? And what impact does it have on the race?
On the one hand, you could say, of course, they're laying off staff because there are fewer contests coming up and they had a very big staff. They don't need as many people now with fewer races to go. On the other hand, this campaign has mishandled big symbolic moments. If you want to convince people that you're in it, you're still trying, you've still got a chance, you cannot lay off this many people. Figure out a way. Or if you're going to, be ready to explain it better than the way they did. So they spent a lot of money. There's a new Washington Post story talking about how they spent a lot of money on consultants, which may not sit so well with their small dollar donors. But this is just it doesn't mean all that much in the scheme of things, except it shows once again that for as good as they've been on so many things, they haven't handled this kind of thing very well.
And let's be clear, they have been very good on some very big things. This campaign, in many ways, even more than the Trump campaign, is a miracle what they've accomplished. People around Bernie Sanders, incredibly, incredibly good. They've done an amazing job.
But amen.
It is the truth that the campaign had 1,000 people working for it, I'm told by informed sources, in Iowa. They've gradually been ratcheting that number down, as most campaigns do, as the number of states recede. And they've been leapfrogging people from state to state. And now they're just kind of running out of runway. In some sense, it's the most natural thing in the world. But to your point, if it's the most natural thing in the world, the day when it happens to be the day after you've lost 4 out of 5 and you happen to be cutting your staff by nearly half just because of the proportions, you got to figure out some way to tell that story that doesn't make it look like you're giving up.
And I'll say one thing. California, really big. I bet you those people could have gone to California, at least some of them, and done something maybe more useful than giving money to the consultants.
Like I say, if you explain it better, do something to have this not be read in the way it's been read.
They've also spent a lot more money in the last couple weeks than some people realize. Perhaps. All right. Up next, more in the GOP race and Donald Trump's path to the nomination after this quick break.